Check, check. Happy Sabbath, everyone. This is a Sabbath morning. We thank God for the privilege we got again to be here in the morning. So we welcome each and everyone and those who are watching online to begin our Sabbath school program. As well, we start with the song service. We are going to sing song 195, Showers of Blessings. Song, let's sing number 108, Amazing Grace. Song, let's sing song number 528, A Shelter in this Time of Storm.
Thank you. Okay, for the next song, let's sing 530, It Is Well With My Soul.
Sabbath, all of you. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. It's a day of rest and gladness. We need to rejoice in the Lord, restore the plan of salvation, recollect, remembering history and repentance. Restore us, O Lord, cause your face to shine, and we shall be saved. Psalms 83. Recounting of God's great deeds on behalf of his people. Remain faithful to God and the covenant with him. Rely upon him because he is a faithful and supreme Lord, sovereign God. We have nothing to fear for the future. So with this thought, I extend a warm and a hearty welcome to all who are here present, children, young and the old. On behalf of the pastor, assistant pastor, and also children ministries director from Union and Southern Asia Division, I take this privilege once again to welcome each and everyone. May God bless us today to worship Him in spirit and truth.
Happy Sabbath. Psalmist says like this, "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for He is good, for His mercy endureth forever." So for His mercy, we have to praise our God. In order to praise our God, let's all rise up for the opening song. Turn to the song number from our church hymnal, 478. Seat our prayer.
Let's all rise for the opening song.
Sing first, okay?
Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, that calls me from my world of care and bids me my Father's throne. Make all my wants and wishes known in season of distress and grief. My soul has often found relief and of escape the tempter's snares by the return. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, thy wings shall my petition bear to Him whose truth and faithfulness engage the waiting soul to bless. And since He bids me seek His face, believe His word and trust His grace, I cast on Him my every care and wait for Thee, sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer. May I Thy consolation share till from Mount Pisgah's lofty height I view my home and take my flight. In my immortal flesh I rise to seize the everlasting prize. And shall while passing through the air, farewell, farewell, sweet hour of prayer.
Let's all reverently close our eyes for the opening prayer. O merciful Father in heaven, we do thank Thee for this bright morning, the word given us to worship Thee. We do thank Thee for the songs that we sang here. Lord, we do thank for all the blessings that we received during the past days. Lord, we do thank Thee that You have given us the life to live for Thee, Lord. Lord, we need Thy presence to be with us throughout this program. Lord, we do thank Thee for the congregation. Lord, we do thank Thee, each and every one of them. Bless them abundantly. Lord, we do thank Thee for all of our Adventist family group, Lord. Lord, this time I submit everything into Thy feet, Lord, as our team of this union leaders, they are going to present today's program, Lord. Please, we need Thine presence be with us especially, and also we need Thine words to spoke to these people, Lord. Lord, we need Thine courage and power from above. Lord, we need Thine Holy Spirit to spread over this sanctuary, Lord. Lord, we submit once again everything, Lord. And also, Lord, give us Thine power and Thine strength. Lord, we do submit each and every one of the program and the activities. So you take care of and you help them to speak what to speak here. Once again, I submit everything into Thy mighty hand of God. We ask these few blessings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, church. Happy Sabbath. My feature talk is entitled Bearing Fruits, Photosynthesis and Christian Life. Science students, they know what photosynthesis is. This photosynthesis plays a very important role in our life, human life, at the same time all the living beings, and in the life of plants itself. Now, nature is teaching us so many things, and God has created this universe beautifully, thoughtfully. If we think of our body, each organ is made up of single cells, small, tiny cells, tissues, organs, organ system. And because all these systems are working together, means they have coordination among them. That is why the functioning of our body is going on well. If there is damage or there is disturbance in any system, many systems are there in our body, respiratory system, nervous system, excretory system, so many systems are in our body. And in each system, there are the different organs, but they have coordination. The same thing with other animals and in the life of plant. Now, what is photosynthesis? Now, here is the diagram given. You can see the plant, roots are there, stem, leaves and flowers. Now, if you look at the color of this leaf, it is green in color. It is green in color. So, photosynthesis will take place this part of the plant. Green plants, chloroplasts. Okay? So, here is the equation given. Now, first, let me tell you what this photosynthesis is. This is the process. This is the process during which carbon dioxide is reacted with water molecule. Six molecules of carbon dioxide will react with six molecules of water. And as a result, there will be a chemical reaction in between these two reactants, and there will be product, sugar and oxygen. But if you look at the middle arrow, on the top it is written light. And just now I told you, chloroplast means the green plants Chlorophyll is there, the green color of that plant leaf is because of the presence of chlorophyll. You look at this arrow, that is light. Now we know there is always balance in atmosphere, carbon dioxide and oxygen. The percentage of carbon dioxide and percentage of oxygen is always maintained. How? It is because of these plants. Because of these plants. Plants prepare their own food. That is why these plants are called as producers. And we animals, human beings, we are consumers. We consume whatever food is prepared by plant. Actually, whatever food we are preparing at home, that is cooking. We are cooking food. But that is not producing food. The plants, they prepare their own food. They prepare their own food during the process called photosynthesis with the help of carbon dioxide, water molecules, and the result we get sugar, C6H12O6, and oxygen. So these plants, they, during this process, they give out oxygen. And in the night, this process is reversed. So this is the way this carbon dioxide is given out. And this is the way the oxygen level and the carbon dioxide level is always maintained by the plant. Now here, carbon dioxide and water, these are the reactants, and glucose and oxygen, these are the products. But the energy is used here for the production of sugar, that is food, and the production of oxygen. Energy is required, and that energy, they are absorbing light from the sun. So this is what chemical equation in photosynthesis. Now, if you look at our spiritual life, let us all draw parallels between photosynthesis and our Christian life. As plants, they require sunlight, water, and carbon dioxide to produce oxygen and glucose. They need, for the production of glucose, they need living water, and then solar energy is used. The same way in our Christian life, we need light. We need light. Sunlight is the important energy. Solar energy is used by plants in photosynthesis. And sunlight serves as the catalyst for growth. Similarly, in our spiritual lives, the light of Christ illuminates our path and gives us direction. Now, from 2 days, now today is the third day, we are having VBS. We are training our Spicer students. This time, very few students enrolled. Last year, the number was more. Anyway, these are the chosen children by God. These are the chosen instruments by God. Okay, so they will go in the field. They will go in the field. What they are carrying with them, they are carrying Christ's light. Christ is sharing us his light. And we have to reflect that light. They are going in their field and they are going to reflect that light with the children, with the people, their parents. As Jesus declared, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. John 8:12. By walking in the light of Christ, Enoch walked with God. We receive guidance, wisdom, and warmth of his love. The second reactant is water. Just as plants, they absorb water from the soil. And that water is conducted to the upper parts of the plant through the tissues, xylem tissues. our souls are also nourished by the living water, which is offered by Jesus Christ. He proclaimed, whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water, welling up the eternal life. John 4:14. So through faith in Christ, our spiritual thirst is quenched and we are refreshed and renewed. So second reactant is water, and Jesus is our living water. We have to drink that water. If you look at that diagram again, you can see those roots, they are absorbing water with the help of those roots, rootlets. The Bible is the ground, Bible is the book. We have to absorb that spiritual food, and we have to conduct that spiritual food to the people around us. My dear Spicer students, it is your duty. You are chosen people. And here you are learning that various things along with other subjects, you are getting spiritual food. And this you have to conduct the upper part of the plant, that is what? The people around you. So look at this diagram, this water is absorbed like that. Jesus is the living water. And we have to drink that water so that the same water we will spread surrounding area with the people around us. Then third reactant is carbon dioxide. Just now I told you carbon dioxide and oxygen level is always maintained in the atmosphere only because of these plants during photosynthesis. So this is the third reactant, carbon dioxide. While plants absorb carbon dioxide to fuel photosynthesis, we as Christians are called to take in breath of God, the Holy Spirit. Now this year we are studying every day these three things, God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit during our daily devotional. So Holy Spirit, we need Holy Spirit. As we live our life on this earth, we have to face different various difficulties. Satan is trying to destroy and destruct our work in our daily life. So we have to be well equipped with this Holy Spirit. Jesus promised his disciples, but the advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. John 14:26. The Holy Spirit empowers us, convicts us of sin, guides us into our truth, enabling us to bear fruits in our daily life. And third part of this photosynthesis, final, that is bearing fruit. Now, let us explore the ultimate purpose of photosynthesis, and it is profound implication for our Christian work. The carbohydrates, the final product during photosynthesis, that is carbohydrate, glucose, and oxygen produced through photosynthesis, serve as the building blocks for plants' growth and development. In a similar way, as Christians, we are called to bear fruits that glorifies God and blesses others. This fruitfulness, Jesus exhorted his disciples saying, I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruits. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Without God, we are nothing. If we are intact with God, intact with Jesus, nothing is impossible in our life. John 15:5. Our union with Christ is vital for spiritual fruitfulness. As we abide in him through prayer, worship, and obedience to his word, we are empowered to bear fruits. Fruit of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness and self-control. Galatians 5:22. This is the fruits of spirit. So this is the photosynthesis, which plays a very important role in our daily life. In our daily life. May God bless us.
Thank you. Good morning and happy Sabbath to all of you. Can you hear me? Okay. All right, so even though it's late, I still have to take this mission report, so I'll just make it short. The title of our mission report this morning is A Startling Voice, and it's a story about Rex and his family. A voice awoke father from his afternoon nap in India in the early 1980s. And that voice was like this: "If you were to die today, what would you do?" It was a very loud voice speaking to him as he was fast asleep. And this voice awoke him. And he looked here and there to see who was shouting like this to him. But he couldn't find anyone in the house. The doors was locked. The windows were closed. And he was wondering, who's shouting to me this message? If you were to die today, what would you do? And he's thinking, who's talking to me? And he was worried, and he prayed to God, "God, I want to know who is speaking to me, who is talking to me." The house was silent, and he was wondering what to do. And about half an hour passed, and suddenly he heard a knock at the door, and outside there stood a Seventh-day Adventist literature evangelist. And his father was so surprised to see this literature evangelist. And he remembered that sometime back, during that day, this literature evangelist had come to the door, and he had told him about the Bible. And after that, this literature evangelist had left, and father had closed the door, and he had gone to sleep. Rex's father, he always considered himself to be a Christian, but he never owned any Bible. He did not have interest also to listen to this man. But after hearing this voice in the afternoon when he was taking his nap, after that, he wanted to know more about the Bible. And so he listened to him, and what the evangelist told him about the Bible was new to him. But he decided to go and learn more from his priest, and he also longed to have a Bible of his own. And he went to buy the Bible. And the Bible was, during those days, it was not as cheap as it is today. It cost him a large amount of money. But he purchased his Bible, and he studied the Bible diligently. But in his study, there were three things that he could not understand. Three questions. One was, why do we bow to images? And another one was, why do we worship on Sunday? And so he took these questions to his priest. And still, his priest could not answer these questions. And he was not pleased that this man was asking him this question. And he said, "This is why we don't give Bibles to people." And so, as his priest could not answer his questions, he also did not want to attend this church any longer with his wife and two sons. One of the sons was 16, and another was 10. And a short time after this, when he stopped attending his church, that Catholic church, after this, the Seventh-day Adventists, they organized an evangelistic meeting. So father took his wife and his sons to attend these meetings. And he also took these three questions that he had to the pastor of the Seventh-day Adventist church. And this pastor, he gave him answer that satisfied him. And so, short time later, father and the mother and their 16-year-old son and 16-year-old son, they joined the Seventh-day Adventist church. But after he joined the Seventh-day Adventist church, his relatives and his neighbors, they were not pleased with him. Like he had five brothers and two sisters, they refused to talk with them. And also the neighbors, they belong to another, the previous church, they also refused to speak to the family. And not only that, he had to even leave his job because there was no Sabbaths off. And so for several years, the family was facing challenging time because of this Sabbath, because of him following the Sabbath truth. And because of that, he also removed his son from that school, from the public school, and he sent him to the Adventist boarding school, that is the E.D. Thomas Memorial School. And he studied there for 6 years, and there he gave his heart to Jesus. And upon graduation, he went to Spicer Memorial College, which was then known as Spicer Memorial College, and now it's known as Spicer Adventist University. And after he completed there, he joined the work, and he's now a pastor, and today he is a leader of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in India, serving as Sabbath School Director for the Southeast India Union of Seventh-day Adventists. Today, Rex's father is no longer alive. He passed away, but he will never be forgotten for opening the first Adventist church in his place, and also for planting many churches with his hard work. And also he was instrumental in leading many people to Christ because of the newfound faith that he got. And Rex is grateful that his father's afternoon nap was interrupted by a voice more than 40 years ago. He is glad that his parents sent him to Adventist boarding school, and he believes that the two experiences changed his life for eternity. He says that, "I am proud that I am a graduate of the school." He says, "The school taught me the truth, and today I am a servant of God." So part of this Sabbath school's 13th Sabbath offering will help reconstruct the rundown girls' dormitory of Rex School, that is E.D. Thomas Memorial Higher Secondary School in Thanjavur, India. So when you give your offering, please remember that whatever you're giving, part of it will go to reconstruct the girls' dormitory in E.D. Thomas Memorial Higher Secondary School. So give your offering liberally so that this offering that you give can be of help to this school, which had been instrumental in educating and saving and bringing many children to the foot of the cross and in God's kingdom. Thank you. May God bless each one of you.
Check. Let us all rise for a closing prayer. Our dear, loving, living Heavenly Father, thank you for the Sabbath that you have given to each one of us to come and enjoy the blessings that you have given to us. And thank you for the richest blessings they have given to each one of us. As we heard from the nature and the mission work that is being done in every parts of the world, this encourages to be more closer to you. Be with each one of us as we go ahead with our rest of the program. We know your mission is our mission, and we are heading towards it. Be with each one of us. We also remember our loved ones, those who are far and near, and all the members who are heading towards the church. Be with each one of us, for I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. On behalf of the Sabbath School Department, I would like to thank Children Minister Directors from Southern Asia Division and the VBS students for taking up today's program. Now we'll divide ourselves for the various lesson study classes. Feel comfortable to join whichever the phase you are comfortable. Have a wonderful Sabbath.
Studies, very brilliant mind, and a very hard-working
person. I really praise God that He's present with us today. Welcome each one of you. Shall we pray and give this time to Mighty God, we give you glory and honor. Gracious God, thank you for our spiritual ancestors. Thank you for the lessons that we can learn from them. Now, Lord, we ask for a double portion of your spirit upon your servant and our teacher, Dr. Varenka. Lord, bless each one of us that we may gain many spiritual insights today. For we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Dr. Justin, for that words of introduction and the prayer. And thank you for choosing to worship with us this morning. Welcome again, Dr. Richard, amidst us. And we are very blessed to have you. We are in lesson number 10, and our lesson is entitled Lessons of the Past. Lessons of the Past. And I believe that all of us have gone through our lesson today. Our key text is taken from Psalm 78. We will be focusing on Psalm 78, 80, 105, 106. And so you can keep your fingers there. And then I would also want to request all of you to kindly contribute the inspiration that you have received from the Lord through the week as you went through the lesson. Our key text is taken from Psalm 78, verse 3 and 4, and it reads, which we have heard and known, and our fathers have told us. We will not hide them from their children, telling to the generation to come the praises of the Lord and His strength and His wonderful works that He has done. What does the key text inspire you? Please kindly share. Let's begin with Dr. Justin. When you read this key text, Psalm 78, verse 3 and 4, what does it reveal to you and inspire you of?
Thank you, sir. It tells me that when I fall, I'm not alone. Others who fell but learned their lessons and came up and rose up. And so I take courage.
You take courage because you know that you are not alone and you are not left alone also, Amen. Right? Anybody else would like to share from this key text when it says, which we have heard and known and our fathers have told us, we will not hide them from their children, telling to the generations to come the praises of the Lord and His strength and His wonderful works, that He has done. Yes, Dr. Sanjeevan.
With reference to this, it is essential for us to refer to Exodus chapter 13, verses 1 to 4. And in Exodus chapter 13, verses 1 to 4, Moses says to the children of Israel, Remember this day, which is the day of Abib, when you were led out from bondage of Egypt to the promised land. And therefore, it is essential for us to remember what the Lord has done for us. And also, if you refer to Exodus 28, where God says, remember the Sabbath day. So as children of God, as members of God's church, it is essential for us, as Moses said, to remember how the Lord has guided us from difficulties to the present times where we have the hope of eternal life. And also we need to remember what God has done for us. He has blessed, hallowed, and sanctified the Sabbath for each one of us so that it can help us to remind ourselves of creation and the love of God.
Thank you. Thank you. We need to remember. So I think today's lesson, I think the historian should be very excited about, because it tells us how important history is. You know, one day I was in our famous Pune ABC Chowk, where we find all books, and I was looking for a history book. and somebody turned around and said, history? I mean, he was sarcastically looking at the person looking for a history book, wondering as to why history at all. I find that he was an engineering student because he was looking for an engineering book. But let us remember, if you forget your history, you have no future. Yes, we have to remember this. And there are some key words in our key text. It says, heard. Have you heard? Do you know? Known. Told us. We are not to hide. We are to tell. We are to praise. Why? Because his strength and his wonderful works. As our Vice Chancellor pointed out, we need to remember what God have done because it gives us hope in the future. Yes, Brother Gaurav.
Yeah, so we see here the crux of the lesson is about history, as you mentioned. And the way we know our past is by hearing those who were before us. So even the memory text says, we have heard from our fathers and we are going to tell to our children. And this is so crucial, how we remember the facts, we share the facts, as we hear and tell to our next generation. So it's very important. Sometimes, whether it's in our secular world or in religious world, the history is misrepresented, it's misconfigured, it's misconstrued, and misinformation is passed on. So just the verse is telling us that we need to be faithful in telling our children. That reminds us of Deuteronomy chapter 6, where verse 7 says, repeat them again and again to your children. And that's a command. God wants us to be a faithful witness to the next generation. Apostle John writes in 3 John, he says, 1 John, he says, what we have heard and seen and witnessed, what we have held, we witness that, we share that. So we need to be a faithful witness as our forefathers have been and pass on the information.
All right, thank you. We need to witness and then make sure that we pass it on. Dr. Richard, you have anything to share with us? I think the mic is right there.
Thank you so much. I'm impressed with the explanation of our brother connecting this Bible text with 1 John chapter 1. And why can we say that we would pass on what we have heard and what we have known? Now, someday in the future, we will be history. And people will learn about what we learn, about what we do right now. So let us make sure that we study carefully. Let us make sure that we listen carefully so that what we pass on will be something true. Because it is going to be from one generation to the next generation and to the next generation. That to the generation, last generation, before Jesus comes, the truth remains the same because we are faithful now. Thank you.
All right, thank you. We need to remember that we will be part of history. What we do today will determine where we stand tomorrow. Yes, you will always find that societies that have no historical records are always behind. Communities and societies that have historical records always are ahead because they learn from the past. So the past becomes a stepping stone to the next. And in our spiritual journey too, why is there all kinds of stories recorded in the Word of God? Word of God says it is there for our reproof, for our correction, isn't it? For our doctrine. Why would the Bible record of the adultery of David? Why would the Bible record of the 11 brothers or the 10 brothers, exploiting the younger brother? Why would Solomon, and the Bible record that Solomon had 1,000 wives or 700 plus 300? But there is a purpose for that. It is for us to learn. And then we are to pass on. Let's go to Psalm 78. Psalm 78, if you read, it's a kind of a long chapter. We don't have the time because today I think we are running short of time. But Psalm 78 talks about how unfaithful the children of Israel were, but how faithful God also is. Isn't it, Dr. Jessen? You have something to share that you found in Psalm 78?
In Psalm 78, we see that the children of Israel coming out of Egypt, their wilderness journey, and settling in Canaan. And we see God's faithfulness. And we also see their murmuring and their unfaithfulness and the desire to go back to Egypt from where they came from. Our lesson points out in the last paragraph of Sunday's lesson, before we get overly judgmental of past generations, we should consider ourselves. Aren't we also forgetful of God's past wonders and neglectful of His covenantal requirements?
Thank you. Thank you. Psalm 78 talks about, as Dr. Jessen have said, of how God led them out of Egypt from bondage through the wilderness to the promised land. But it also talks about how unfaithful they were, how they grumble and complain. You know, if you read Numbers, you will find they even complain about garlics. Isn't it? Yes, garlics and onion and interesting, isn't it? But as Dr. Jessen have read from our lesson, before we become so judgmental about who the children of Israel were, how they grumble and complain, it is important for us to examine ourselves. Are we also not like the children of Israel? Yes. They went to the border of the promised land and they didn't want to get inside. Yes. As Dr. Sharad always says, we are in the end of the end time. But how many of us are willing, ready to enter the promised land, or are we one among like the children of Israel, not willing to get inside? If you read the experience, you'll find that they said, we are like grasshoppers. Are we like grasshopper Christians today? With a grasshopper mindset. Are we like the children of Israel? Oh, we are small, we are weak. What can we do? Can we enter? Are we fit? Grasshopper mindset? Are we like the children of Israel? Every time we face difficulty, are we complaining? If I were to give time to our Vice Chancellor, I'm sure he will have days of experiences of how many arrows of complaints come to him. Yes? For every little thing we complain. Were the children of Israel not like that? Yes. Psalm 78 talks about, let's read verse 7 and 8. Let's read verse 7 and 8. Why should we remember that? Why should we remember history and the past experience and learn lesson? It says here, that they may set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep His commandments. And may not be like their fathers, a stubborn and rebellious generation, a generation that did not set its heart aright and whose spirit was not faithful to God. So why should we read the Bible? Why should we remember the stories of the children of Israel? Why should we remember the stories of the kings of the children of the Israelite kingdom and Judah? Why should we go through the Bible and know them so that we will have hope? We will not be like our fathers whose hearts were not set aright, who were stubborn and rebellious, and who were not faithful. So why is it there, and what lessons are we to learn? We are to be hopeful because of the strength and the faithfulness of God, so that we will not be unfaithful, so that we will not be rebellious, so that we will not be stubborn. Let's read verse 19, chapter 78, verse 19. We'll just read a few verses, and if you have anything to share, please feel free to join in, okay? Verse 19. Yes, they spoke against God and they said, can God prepare a table in the wilderness? What a question, isn't it? Let's read that again. You heard that question, right? I hope. Yes, they spoke against God. And how did they speak against God? They said, can God prepare a table in the wilderness? Let me ask you a question. Did God prepare a table in the wilderness for the children of Israel? They needed water, God gave them water, isn't it? They wanted to eat non-veg, and God gave them billions of birds out of nowhere. God gave them, the Bible says, God gave them food that they did not know what it was, and they called it manna. Angelic food. Did God prepare a table in the wilderness? Was God able to prepare a table in the wilderness? If you read towards the end of the journey of the children of Israel, what did God tell them? I took care of you for 40 years, and your sandals have not worn out, your clothes have not been torn. Come on, class. If this is not a lesson for us to learn, are we asking the same question today? Can God prepare a table in the wilderness of this struggle? Are you struggling financially and are you asking God, can God prepare a table for me? Is your institution, your church, your community, your family struggling that you are asking the question, can God prepare a table? Let's turn to Psalms 23. I think you all know this by memory, but I think let's read it together. What does Psalms 23 reads? Verse 5. You prepare a table before me in the presence of who? My enemies. Come on, class. We cannot forget this. And if you read, you will find that God always prepared a table in the wilderness for the children of Israel. And that is the same God that you and I profess to worship and believe today. And if that God prepared a table in the wilderness and out of nowhere, I believe He can still, and He will. Yes, sir. We need the mic somewhere.
We especially the present generation, we need to praise God for giving each one of us an opportunity to experience what He did for the children of Israel in the wilderness, and that is during the pandemic time. The pandemic times were difficult times, but all of us were cared by God.
Amen.
And that is a simple example that He prepares a table for His children and cares for them.
Oh yes, God prepares and God cares. Don't doubt it. But if you forget the past, you will doubt. Because you do not know the past. What God have done for you, and therefore you will doubt. Your faith will be shaken and you will be hopeless because you do not know the past. You see? And that is why it is important for us to read the Bible and know what God did in the past and what God can, because He promised and He never goes back on His promises. Yes? Let's read. Go back to Psalm 78. Because I find exciting verses here. Please turn with me to Psalms 78, 22. And it says, because they did not believe in God and did not trust in His salvation. So, if you read the Old Testament, you find every time the children of Israel get into problem, is it because they believe or they did not believe? You will find, you read, let's just take one example of the book of Judges. They get into trouble because they did not believe. The book of Judges said everybody did what they think was right. They get into trouble, they turn to God, and then God prepared a table by sending a judge and delivered them. For 20 years, 40 years, they would enjoy prosperity in the Lord, and then they would go back. Psalm 78, verse 22 says, because they did not believe, what does it say? Verse 22, because they did not believe in God and did not trust in His salvation. Read with me verse 35. Then they remembered that God was their rock and the Most High God their Redeemer. Nevertheless, they flattered Him with their mouth and they lied to Him with their tongue. Oh, come on, class. Are we also like the children of Israel? Flattering God? Lying to God? Thinking God is a fool? For their hearts was not steadfast with Him, nor were they faithful in His covenant. But He, being full of compassion, forgave their iniquity. And He did not destroy them. Yes, many a time He turned His anger away and did not stir up all His wrath. For He remembered that they were but flesh, a breath that passes away and does not come again. Come on, class. They lied to God. They flattered God. They think God is a fool who does not know. But God, in His unlimited compassion, turned away from His wrath, knowing that they were just flesh. That's the God we serve. Yes, Brother Gaurav.
Yeah, I think this is a beautiful depiction of what the gospel is.
Right.
Closes the loop of the gospel. We have been unfaithful. God has been faithful to us. In the Old Testament, we see God calling Him as their bride, as their nation. In fact, I'm just opening this in Isaiah 5. God says, after all of this history of Israel, bringing them out of Egypt, giving them the Canaan land, and then before He sent them to Babylon, He said, what more could have been done by me for my vineyard? What else could I do? He had been faithful, and then He calls us to be faithful. So the gospel is simply, we have been unfaithful from the start. David says, I am born in iniquity, but God has been faithful regardless. In fact, even in some of the minor prophets, He says He had given us divorce, but He still calls us back because we are His bride. And God is saying, because I love you so much, even when you did not love me, Paul writes us, when we were yet sinners, He died for us. So that's the gospel. Our obedience followed by God's faithfulness in the face of our unfaithfulness.
All right. God is faithful even though we are unfaithful. Even though we don't believe and we lie to God and play a harlot with Him, yet He is still faithful. Isn't it? Yes. What an amazing grace. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound, isn't it? Yes, and let us not take that for granted. Our lesson says, do not take that for granted. Because if you read Genesis chapter 6, God says, my spirit shall not always strive with men. So let us remember that God is faithful. And if you remember the faithfulness of God and how He went, as recorded in the Bible, we know how faithful God has been. We cannot but praise God. Yes, we cannot but praise God. Think back of your own life. The past 30, 40, 50, 60 years, 65, 70 years that you have lived, think. Has there been a point of time that God had not been faithful? Was God not faithful, or were you not faithful at some given point of time? You will always find that God was always faithful. When I was reading the lesson and I was thinking back of my over half century of life, I cannot imagine how I am here today. Running around growing up in the forest of Manipur, almost half naked, almost nothing around the body. And today I'm here. How is that possible? Here is a man standing in front of you who can hardly remember the face of the parents because they passed away long, long ago when he was a small little child, and here I am. If that is not God's faithfulness, then what it is? And I'm sure you all have your own stories of how God had been faithful to you. If God was not faithful, I don't think any one of us would be sitting here today. I think there is a song, my friend Carol, I think there is a song that says, count your blessings, name them one by one, and you would be surprised how much He has done for you. But many times we fail to count our blessings, am I right? We fail to count our blessings. I'm sure if I ask Dr. Richard, I'm sure he will have lots and lots of stories to tell of how God had been faithful. I'm sure my friend Carol, I'm sure our Vice Chancellor will have hundreds of stories of how God had been faithful. Brother Gaurav, I'm sure nothing less. But the question is, do we count the blessings? Do we look back in the past in our life and do we praise God or do we complain? I think if we really sit back and look back in the past and think of how faithful God has been, I think there is nothing to complain about, but only to be thankful. And that's what Psalms, let's go to the next lesson. Psalms 105 is all about. It says, remembering history and the praise. You can't, but help. But you can't only praise God because you know your history. You see this? Yeah, I think Brother Gaurav, you are excited to share something here.
Yeah, just to, I love what you're sharing, the line of reasoning, and just to add a nod, the final point, the punchline would be in the same line of reasoning is, because God has been faithful, when we count all His blessings, that gratefulness, that praising God brings out obedience to Him. As God said, I have delivered you from Egypt, that's why now you obey. So our obedience is just a thankfulness to God. Thank you so much for all your blessings. And so I want to love you back because you have loved me first. And it's not meriting something in front of Him. It's just a thank you to Him. And so we obey.
All right. Our obedience is just our return to God for being thankful. Yes, Brother Asha. I think we can pass on the mic over there. Because our online viewers would like to hear your voice and your contribution.
We have a very beautiful memory text. From this, I want to share an observation. I think this is not just a statement, but this is an assignment for every church member to tell the great things, wonders God had done for our people in the past, and to tell about it to others in the coming generations. I think it is the duty, not of just the historians, the pastors, the mission workers, but of every church members. Thank you.
All right. It is our duty to tell the world how faithful God has been. And I think how you can tell the world how faithful God has been is through your life. Live that life that others can see and read. Yeah? Thank you for that contribution. Yes, let's read. Let's read verse 15. 105 verse 15 says, God says, saying, do not touch my anointed ones. What is God saying? Don't touch them. Should you not praise God? Simply God put a hedge around you. Can't touch them. You remember the story of Job? What did Satan say? Hey, come on, yeah. What are you saying? You put a hedge around them, him. I cannot do anything. Is there a truth? Yes, it is. When God protects you, Satan can do nothing. Should we not praise God for that? So how is it that Satan is able to penetrate into our life, into our institutions, into our community, and trouble? We got to think about this. Satan told God, I cannot touch Job because you have put a hedge around it. God says, fine, I will take it off. And Satan jumps in. Then all kinds of things started. But Job remained faithful. His wife came and said, hey man, you fool, just instead of struggling, you just curse God and die. But Job could never do that because he knows his history. He knows history, and he knows, even though he does not know behind the curtain as to what is happening, he still knows the history that God was always faithful, and God is going to be faithful. Yes, sometimes God allows you to go through because I believe, you know, what was the question God asked? Was it Satan who brought up Job first or was it God? If you read, you'll find God was the one who brought up first. Do you know my faithful servant Job? Yes, because I believe God was confident in what Job would stand for. Will God be confident enough to say the same thing about us today? Do you know your history? Are you praising God or are you complaining and grumbling? Is God confident enough to throw you into the arena and the world is watching you? God knows that you will be faithful because you know your history. And you know, and God knows that God has been faithful and He will be faithful with you there. Yes, Gaurav.
Yes, I think that's a beautiful point where we know our history, so we know our God as a person. We know His heart. And in spite of what's happening around us, sometimes circumstances do not show us how good God is because we are in the midst of this great controversy. But God can trust us that He has known me enough that regardless of any bad thing that might happen to him, he knows that I am good. God is good all the time. And there is a song that I just remember, God is too wise to be mistaken.
Yes.
So when you don't understand, Job could not understand, but the song says trust his heart. Because Job could know the heart of God. He could not understand why some things are happening, and that's true for us. What the lesson we have from history is we know the person of God. And that's the difference between paganism and true Christianity. Pagans would see that, if there is thunder, if there is problem, God is angry. But that's not how Christians think. Well, there may be thunders, there may be storms, but I know my God, He is love, regardless of anything that may happen.
Oh yeah, thank you. Do you know God enough? Do you know the God that you worship enough? That's the question. As we go through this wilderness of sin and life, do you know God enough? Because He has promised, lo, I am with you always. He never said, maybe I will be with you. He said, lo, I am with you always. I will never leave you nor forsake you. He never said that you will not have storms, but He said, I will be with you. I am with you. Do you know? Do you know God enough? Do you think God was with Job? I believe. Do you think God was with Daniel in that lion's den? I'm sure He must have told the lions, you just shut your mouth, don't touch him, I'll give you breakfast in the morning. And the lions obeyed. Do you think God was with the three friends of Daniel in the fiery furnace? Of course. Yes, you read Isaiah chapter 43. What does it say? God says, when you walk through the fire, it will not consume you. When you walk through the waters, it will not drown you. If you know God, you cannot doubt, but you will only praise. You remember the experience of Peter? When he walked on the water and he saw the storm, he became fearful and began to drown. Jesus pulled him up and he did not say the storm came to an end. It says only when they stepped into the boat, then the storm came to an end. What does it mean? Jesus walked with him in that stormy water to the boat. Do you know God enough? And if you know God enough, I am sure you will only praise. The difficulty that you are going through is just a phase that you are going through. To refine us of our doubts and unbelief. Do we know God? If we know God, if we know the history, I think there is only to praise. Let's move on. Let's move on. But I think let's read verse 19. I have marked it, and as we're running against time. It says, until the time that his word came to pass, the word of the Lord tested him. Yes? Until the time. Hold on. That's important. Hold on. Until the time. God is testing, you know? You remember that story? The goldsmith would hold that gold in the fire until the time. What did the goldsmith tell that person who was sitting next to him and asking the question? He said, I hold the gold in the fire until the time I see my image in the gold, then I know that it is refined. You see this? He does not let it go. He held it, but in the fire. You see this? Do you know God enough? Do you believe that God is holding you in that testing time? Yeah, some of us are members of the Spicer Adventist University. We have all kinds of challenges, but I believe God is holding us. If we hold on and held on to that, I think time will come when He will say, enough, come out, you are a refined gold that should shine. Yes, you might be going through personal experiences today, and you might be wondering why, but remember, if you know God enough, He is holding you. Yes, let's move on to Psalms 106, remembering history and repentance. Dr. Jessen, what does Psalms 106 talks about?
Sir, I will read one verse. Psalm 106. Blessed are those, verse 3, blessed are those who keep justice, and he who does righteousness at all times. Also verse 6, we have sinned with our fathers. We have committed iniquity. We have done wickedly. This helps us remember our weaknesses, our sins, like our forefathers.
And once we realize that we are weak and sinner, what is the next step? Confession leads to repentance. Am I right? Yes. It is only on the realization and acceptance that we confess and repent. Otherwise, if we don't accept and say, no, I didn't do it, how will you ever repent? Yes. No, I find these things very interesting. Let's read verse 20. Thank you, Dr. Jessen, for sharing that. Verse 20, you read, thus they changed their glory into the image of an ox that eat grass. Come on, grass. Did God create us in that? God created us in the likeness of God, in the image of God. But who changed? You read Psalms 106. This is the outcome of the preceding verses. They changed their image. Who changed? It did not say God changed their image. It says they changed their image. It did not say God changed their image into an image of an ox that eat grass. It says they changed their image because they did not believe. Remember that? Yes? God is not the one who makes us to sin. It is we who choose to change our image into something else rather than the image of God. Let's also read verse 35. Come with me to verse 35. I know it's already 10:40. We should be winding up now. But they mingled with the Gentiles and learned their works. Come on, class. Are we setting the standard that the others learn from us? Or are we trying to become like them? We want to become like them. Was not that the lesson that we learned from the experience of the children of Israel asking God for a king? We want to be like them. We want to have a king like them. And God told, you can have, but I will tell you before I give it to you, your king, once you have it, will be like this, like this, like this, like this. And they said, we still want to have. Yes? Uh-huh. Are we trying very, very hard, sweat and blood, to become like them? Or are we living, remembering our history and the Bible and the Word of God, that we are like reflecting the image of God, that they want to become like us? I think this is important. Are we the benchmark, or are they our benchmark? God has set the benchmark for us, and are we obeying, remembering it, that the world can see the light in us, and then we become the benchmark? Or are we becoming like them? That's where the problem is. As long as we remember, what will we do? We are weak and frail and sinners. We will repent of our sins. And if we repent of our sins, what does the Bible say? God is faithful to forgive. Let's quickly go to the next lesson and we will close with this. If we come to Psalms 80, it talks about a vineyard that God brought out, planted, and failed. Was it God who failed? I want you to turn with me to Luke chapter 13, verse 6 and 9 to 9, and you'll also find a parable of Jesus, am I right? That a man took a fig from somewhere and planted in the midst of the vineyard, and for 3 years came looking for fruit and found no fruit. And what did they tell? Cut it down, throw it away. Yes. Class, I think it indicates to us that our time is up. Question today that I want to leave the class and for all of us is, are we like that fig tree planted, chosen and planted in the midst of the vineyard? Come on, class. Who plants a fig tree in the midst of a vineyard? Nobody. But I'm sure there was a purpose. And I want you to remember that all of you are placed where you are, chosen by God to bear fruit. Is God finding fruit on you or bearing nothing that He tells the gardener to cut down? Are we like the vineyard, children of Israel, bearing no fruit? Simply because they fail to learn lessons. Simply because they fail to know and remember who God is. Are we like them today? I hope not. I hope that we will be vineyard that will be bearing so much. We will be the fig tree in the midst of the vineyard, chosen from somewhere and planted there, bearing fruit that God will never say, cut it down. Let us remember our history and have hope and believe that God is faithful. And if God had prepared a table in the midst of the wilderness, He can still. As you say, God is too wise to be wrong. God is never wrong. Let us learn from the past. History should never be forgotten, because history will give you hope to step into the future. May the Lord bless us. And I would like to request Dr. Richard, if you can kindly close us in the prayer.
Let us pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for this wonderful lesson. And every time we remember history, help us to remember you, that you were there and you are now here with us, and you will be always with us until Jesus comes. Thank you so much, Father. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Thank you. God bless you. We'll see you next Sabbath. I am Dr. Paul's cousin.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he told me a lot about you and this is your younger brother. Yes. Good to have you and so blessing to you. Have a blessed Sabbath. Sabbath.
No, yeah, no, yeah. I'll call you. Two of us will go together.
Good morning.
I'm sorry about the
confusion. No. They wrote it that way.
Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Yeah.
We would like to invite you all to join us singing some hymns. For the first song, we'll sing 462. Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
They should make a poster, I think.
Of friends.
For the next song, we'll sing 286. 286, Wonderful Words of Life.
Good morning and a very happy Sabbath to all of you, dear church members. Today, God has granted each one of us again another Sabbath day in our life. And this Sabbath day has not been used by anyone who are on this earth. We want to thank the Lord for this opportunity coming to worship Him in this sanctuary. And there are many people who want to have this kind of opportunity, but do not have this opportunity. On behalf of Spicer Church family, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to each one of you. This morning, we would like to extend a very special welcome to our children ministry directors from different parts of India. Mrs. Sheila Raj, from East Central India Union, Mrs. Sakuntala Chandansive from Western India Union, Mrs. Betty Lingdo from Northeast India Union, Mrs. Eshwarama from South Central India Union, Mrs. Rushila Tirki from Northern India Union, Mrs. Teresa Moses from Southeast India Union, Mrs. Kochu Tresla from Southwest India Union, Pastor Jayaselvan Seludurai from Andaman, and Pastor Kumar Chatri from Bhutan. Last but not the least, the speaker for this hour, Mrs. Midrula Lakra from Southern Asia Division. And we would like also to extend a very warm and special welcome to Dr. Richard Sabuin. He is our GC Associate Education Director. He was born and brought up from Indonesia. He is also a liaison officer for Southern Asia Division Higher Education Institutions. Prior to his GC appointment, he was the Dean of Ayas Theological Seminary at Philippines. After that, he moved to Northern Pacific Division as Sabbath School and Education Director. And in short, he is a man of integrity and strict to principle. We also would like to extend a very special welcome to all our guests, visitors who are coming to worship with us. And we want all of you to feel at home because this house belongs to the Lord, the Creator. And as a Christian, we should always feel at home in the house of prayer. This moment, we would like to invite Pastor A.S. Verekan for child dedication.
Good morning, church, and it is so exciting to have a child of God brought to the Lord to be dedicated. And so I would like to invite Mr. and Mrs. Sed to bring their little daughter, Ariel, and Edward to be dedicated to the Lord this morning. I also want to invite the family members and friends. If you are around, please come and join the family to show that you are there to support the family, the parents, in bringing up the child in the Lord. You know, our Lord Jesus loves little children, and our children ministry have emphasized this. God, Jesus said, bring those little children to me. Until and unless we are like the little children, we have no part in God's kingdom. And bringing children to God to be dedicated is biblical. So this morning, the whole family is here. Brother Sed, his family, dedicating little Aria, and Sed's sister, and the older brother's family are also here, and some friends. Thank you for being here. Church, this morning I want to read this text from the Word of God that we find in 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 24. Now when she had weaned him, she took him up with her with three bulls, one ephah of flour and a skin of wine, and brought him to the house of the Lord in Shiloh, and the child was young. Yes, just like Hannah bringing the child to the Lord when the child was young. This morning, Seth and the family have brought little Aria to the Lord. Then they slaughtered the bull and brought the child to a priest Eli. And she said, Hannah said, "Oh my Lord, as your soul lives, my Lord, I am the woman who stood by you here praying to the Lord." And I believe that brother said, and madam, you would have knelt down on your knees and prayed to the Lord to bless you with a daughter after you got that handsome Edward. Bless us with a daughter, and here you are blessed. And may you also praise God like how Hannah did that day. Verse 27, "For this child I prayed, and the Lord has granted me my petition, which I ask of him. Therefore, I also have lent him to the Lord." What a profound statement. Hannah said, "Lord, I lend Samuel to you." And I pray that your prayer today will be, "Lord, we lend little Aria back to you." As long as he lives, but I want to change that word here, as long as she lives, she shall be lent to the Lord. So they worship the Lord there. May you always lend little Aria to the Lord. May you always pray that she will be in the will of the Lord for the rest of her life. And chapter 2, verse 21 says, "And the Lord visited Hannah so that she conceived and bore 3 more sons and 2 daughters." Oh, it's my blessing that you'll have many more children, and then you'll have many more dedications to come. Meanwhile, the child Samuel grew before the Lord. I pray and I bless today that little area will grow before the Lord. I will close with this, that we find in chapter 3, verse 19. "So Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him, and let none of his words fall to the ground." So Ariel grew, and the Lord was with her, and let none of her words fall to the ground. May that be the blessing of little Ariel as she grow day by day. But as she grow day by day, Brother Seth and Madam, I want to remind you that God have told in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 7, he says, "Teach your child day and night, when you get up, when you go for work, when you sleep, teach your child the commandments and the statutes and ordinances of God." The word of God also says, "Train up your child in the way she should go, that she may never depart from it when she grow up." And church, may we as members of this great family of God also extend our support and blessing and prayer to the family as they train up little Edward and Ariel in the Lord. I just want to ask a question to the parents this morning. Will you commit to the Lord this morning that you will train up little Ariel, lend her to the Lord, and make sure that she knows God and follow him all through her life? Will that be your commitment to the Lord this morning? May that be your blessing, and may the Lord be with you as we offer the prayer this morning. I don't know, we'll try. Shall we pray? Loving Father in heaven, this beautiful Sabbath morning, we bring little Ariel to you, like how Hannah brought Samuel to you that day. We know that you have answered the prayer of Seth and his wife. You know, we know, and we believe that you are the one who sent little Ariel and chose Seth and his wife to be her parents on this earth. I pray that you will bless them with wisdom to train them her up. I pray that you will be with little Ariel like how you were with Samuel. May she grow up in you, knowing you, following you, and fearing you. May she grow up in favor with you and with everyone around. May she find favor in you, Lord. May you bless her with not only beauty from outside, but with beauty from inside. May she be the girl that will draw many souls to the foot of the cross. May she be the reason why the family would be blessed, like how Potiphar's house was blessed for the sake of Joseph. May she be the reason why parents would be found in the church. And may she be the reason why your blessings would flow through the family into the community. But above all, I pray that when you come in the clouds of heaven, may Ariel, Edward, and the family be found ready to go with you to live for eternity. For we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
want to thank you, Pastor A.S. Varekan, for the child dedication. As we embark on this journey of spiritual renewal together today, let us remember the words of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31. But they who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. We'd like to announce the announcement we have for our church. This Sabbath, we are very fortunate to have our children ministry directors from Southern Asia Division with us. They are leading our worship services today. March 16, 2024, that is the following week, that's coming week, will be celebrated as the Global Youth Day, GYD, by the youth and young adult of our church around the world. Okay. The theme for this year, GYD, is Show Up in the Cities. Our AY officers are working on making it a special event for the entire church congregation. So we request all the church members to pray for them as they prepare for this great event. And the bookmarks and the badges are available as 20 rupees, and t-shirts are available at 300 rupees. Those who want to take part, you can meet the AY officers to get this. And those who would like to contribute money or in kind, you can approach our AY leader so that your gift will reach to the people who are around us. And this beautiful flower that adorned our church today are contribution from the family of Mr. Seth Gonmay in thankfulness to the Lord for his blessing in their life. May the Lord continue to bless them as they continue to serve him. Sabbath afternoon appointment. Our Adventist youth program will be taken up by Health Department of our church at 5 p.m. in this house of prayer. Those who would like to join, please join them. Join us at 5 p.m. in this house of prayer. Our Bible study class will continue to meet at 4 p.m. in the pastor's office today. And Pathfinder Club will meet at 2:45 p.m. near the administrative building. And lay activities members will be going for house visitation this Sabbath. Kindly gather at admin building by 2:55 p.m. We have good news from Family Department, Family Ministry Department. Family Ministry Department will be organizing a program on 16th of March, that is next week. This is for teenage parents. The program, is entitled Addressing Family Issue in Christ-like Manner with aim strengthening families for eternity. Okay, this will be held at 6 p.m. in Student Center next week. We have some prayer requests. Let us continue to pray for the class 10 and 12 students who are continuing their examination. And kindly also pray for Pastor Enoch Monicum and family as they grieve the loss of their dear son. And let us also remember Pastor Selvin Murthy, a former treasurer of Southern Asia Division, who is mourning the loss of his beloved wife. Let us also pray for Mr. Bula Das as he is admitted in the hospital. And let us also pray for Dr. Boxer Kapteng. He is suffering from chest pain this morning. He has been taken to hospital. We do not know what news, what is the problem yet. But let us pray that no big issue will happen on him. Let us continue to pray for our brother and sister who are seeking our prayer on their behalf, Mr. and Mrs. Joel, as they met with accident, Dr. John Fowler, Mrs. Jaswinder Gill, Mr. Gilbertson, Mrs. Linda Ramnay Zuali, Mrs. Manohari Matthew, Mrs. Anju, Mr. Malik Arjun, Mrs. Saroja Tambi, Mrs. Amani Jarnadan, Mr. Chimpong. Our speaker for this divine hour is Mrs. Mridula Lakra. She is the director of Children Ministry in Southern Asia Division. And it is our request that let us pray for her, that God will use her to speak to each one of us. It is our sincere prayer that may this divine service be a time of renewal and rejuvenation for each one of us. May we find the strength to soar to new height. May we find endurance to persevere in our trial. And may we find faith to walk boldly on our spiritual journey. I would like to invite each one of us, let us worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Thank you.
Mighty Father in heaven, we like to submit ourselves to you. Fill us with the Spirit. Accept our meditation and worship. Be with us throughout this holy hour. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning and a happy Sabbath to each and every one of you. Happy Sabbath. Okay, our hymn of praise is 375, Work for the Night is Coming.
Let's all rise. I request the congregation to kneel as we seek the Lord in prayer. If not able to kneel down, you can sit on a bench. Our gracious, loving Father, thank you, Lord, for this beautiful morning. Thank you, Lord, for the beautiful Sabbath day to come to your presence, to worship you, to adore you, to glorify you. Thank you, Lord, for the great opportunity to given to us. There are many in the world that are not able to see this day. You are so gracious to us to see this day, to celebrate this holy Sabbath in your holy sanctuary. Thank you, Lord, for all your blessings. Thank you, Lord, for good health. Thank you, Lord, for your marvelous leading. Thank you, Lord, for good health, good wisdom, good knowledge. Lord, we thank you so much for everything you have done to our life, Lord. Lord, your word says, where two or three gather in your name, you are there in the midst. Lord, we are welcome you in this holy presence. Lord, we welcome you here in this holy sanctuary. We need your presence today from beginning to end. Lord, this morning we are praying for all those who are admitted in the hospital, all those who are sick and suffering, all those who are in need. Almighty God, you be with them and take care of them, Lord, and heal their disease. You know everything what they're undergoing. Almighty God, you be with them and heal them, Lord. Lord, very especially we're praying for all the names are mentioned in the church bulletin. Almighty God, you heal them, you take care of them, you be control of every need, Lord. Almighty God, you are the sustainer, you are the provider, you are the caretaker for all of us. God Almighty, you be with us today as we are going to hear your word from your servant, Mrs. Mridula Lakra. Almighty God, you be with her and hide her completely, Lord, so that we may hear your silent voice from heavenly throne. Lord, we be richly blessed from here and go back to our respective places. Lord, this Sabbath we are celebrating the World, Lord, the Children's Program Day here in Spicer Adventist University. Almighty God, we praying for all the VBS children. They are taking the training to go and reach the unreached people in all over the Southern Asia division. Lord, you take care of them, Lord, and provide their need so that they will be going different parts of the Southern Asia division. Every corner and nook and corner, Lord. God Almighty, you be with them and empowering them, Lord, so that they'll reach younger one. Through the younger one, they'll reach all the families in this Southern Asia division. If with thy grace, let the family will be converted, the family will be touched to your kingdom, Lord. Lord, thank you so much for all your great blessings. Lord, this time we are especially praying for Spicer Adventist University. Bless the Vice Chancellor. Lord, bless all the staff and faculty and the supporting staff. Be with everyone, Lord. Lord, please bless all the lay members. They are the strength and for the church. Lord, thank you for everything you have given to us. As we go from here, you be with us. Let us go with peacefully so that we can come back next week as a very peaceful heartly. Thank you for everything. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen.
At this time, I will read from the text, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6 to 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6 to 9. Here it says, "But this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver." With this thought, I call for the one who has come with the portion of blessings that we need to return to the Lord. I call for tithes and special offering. If you have, you can come forward. Now I call upon our deacons to come forward to collect a free will offering.
योग्य यीशु भरोसे मन तू रहा, जो कुछ तूने कहा था उसे पूरा भी तूने किया। विश्वास योग्य यीशु भरोसे मन तू रहा, जो कुछ तूने कहा था उसे पूरा भी तूने किया। धन्यवाद हर दिन, शुक्रिया हर समय, आभारी है हर बात में, शब्द भी कम पड़ जाते। धन्यवाद हर दिन, शुक्रिया हर समय, आभारी है हर बात में, कैसे हम वर्णन करें। सरल बनाया बंद दरवाजा
Shall we all rise?
Shall we close our eyes for the prayer? Almighty Father in heaven, thank you for the life that you have given to each one of us, dear Lord, that we could gather together in your sanctuary to sing song and to praise your name. What a privilege, Lord, that we are able to serve the mighty God who has created the heaven and the earth, Lord, as we have gathered the portion of your blessing. We request you to bless on it. May you multiply this offering and use it for the mighty cause. Dear Father in heaven, we request you to
Make each one of us a cheerful giver, Lord. There are many areas in this world which are unentered. Until today, many people have not known about thee, Lord, about your birth, about your death, and that you are in heaven and soon you are going to come to take us to heaven, Lord. But this message has not gone around. Help us so that we may support this ministry, and through this ministry, many people will get to know about your coming. Lord, I'd like to thank you for all the blessings, and may you multiply this offering, and especially, Lord, the ones who have given the special offering, and the purpose for which they have given, only you know it, Lord. May their desires be met. May they know that you accept the offering just like the poor widow, Lord, who gave 2 mites. And you said it was a great offering. She was the one who had given plenty. Lord, bless them in a very special way. And may their desires be met. And Lord, there may be some who were unable to give the offering. Bless them so that next time they will be able to give the offering. At this moment, like to surrender the speaker of the hour, Mrs. Lakra, Lord. May you touch her lips. May you speak through her, Lord, so that we will be spiritually nourished, that we may receive the message through her. And may this message inspire each one of us, and may we be drawn closer to thee. Thank you once again for all the blessing. Help us to keep the Sabbath day holy, and forgive us for all the mistakes that we have committed. For I ask all this blessing in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Yeah, I can see you're smiling. Sit down. Come here. Sit here. Okay, today you like to listen to story? Okay, I'm going to tell you the story of John Harper. What is his name? John Harper. He is called as the hero of the Titanic. Have you heard about the Titanic ship? Very good. How big was that ship? Very big. And what happened to that ship? It crashed. Very good. Good, good. So most of you know the story. But have you heard about John Harper? No, isn't it? Okay, John Harper, he was born in Scotland in a small village in 1872 into a very good Christian family. His parents taught him from God's word, taught him how to pray. And he grew up just like one of you, like all of you here. He grew up to be a very good boy. When he was 14, anybody here? Okay. When he was 14 years, he decided to give his heart to Jesus. So he took baptism and said, I want to give my heart to whom? Jesus. Through baptism. And after that, he went, kept on attending church every week. He would pray every day, morning, evening. He would read the Bible. How many of you read your Bibles? Show me your hands. Yes. And how many of you pray? Very good. Very good. Okay. John Harper too started praying. He would pray morning and evening. And when he became 18 years of age, he wanted to preach God's word. He wanted to preach. And he didn't go to any pulpit or any church to preach. But he would go to the street corners, empty street corners, and he would preach to the people of who passed by. He would preach. John Harper would do that. Okay?
Hey boys, you listen these words. God is light, God is life. And also, you have to listen these words. Sin is darkness, and also sin is death. Hey brother, you have to listen these words.
Okay. So at what age did John Harper start to preach? At what age? Come, sit down. Sit down. At what age? 18 years he started to preach to all the people who passed by those streets. He was very enthusiastic in his preaching. He grew up to become a preacher. He was like a? Yes, like a pastor, like a priest. Okay. Then he pastored many churches. And he became a renowned evangelist, going to many countries to preach. Once he was called to Chicago, to the Moody Church. You can see the picture of John Harper? Yes. He went to Chicago. Where did he go? Chicago. He went to preach. Yes. You want water? Sit down, sit down. And he preached for 3 months, continuously. And every day, people would come to listen to John Harper. How many months he preached for?
3 months.
Many people gave their heart to God. And once again, within 6 months, he was again called to the Moody Church to preach. In Chicago. So in those days there were no aeroplanes. I'm sorry, I'm drinking water because my throat is not good. So he wanted to go the second time. And he was by then 39 years old. He had a daughter. He lost his wife while she gave birth to the child. His daughter was 6 years of age, and he, along with his daughter and with his sister, got on to the ship, which was the Titanic. The Titanic was the largest ship ever built in those days. What's that?
It was considered as the largest ship in the world.
Yes, very good. You have good general knowledge, isn't it? And people thought the builders who built that ship, they built it in such a way that they thought that it would not sink. Oh, yes. How many lifeboats? Okay, there were only 16 lifeboats into the ship because they thought this ship would never sink. It will not sink. And there was almost 2,400 and above passengers traveling in that ship. Along with them was John Harper, his daughter, and his sister. It was April 12, 14. Yeah, you know better. That's good. Thank you. April 14, 1912. But earlier, it took 3 days of journey. And on April 14th, at 11:30 p.m. in the night, what happened? This big ship crashed. It struck what? An iceberg. And what happened when it crushed? It scraped the sides of the Titanic, making a big hole, and all the water gushed into the ship. And what happened to the ship? It started to sink. People were shouting, screaming, running hither, thither, not knowing what to do, running for their lives. And here was John Harper. He wanted to do something. He knew that people were perishing. People were going to lose their lives. But what about them? Do they know about Jesus? He was worried. So he went onto the deck. He took his daughter and his wife and told the men who were trying to rescue them into the lifeboats, "Here, rescue my daughter and my sister." But he didn't want to get into the lifeboat. He said, "No." And he went to everybody, "Are you saved? Come." He kept asking people. How old was he? 39 years old. The ship went 180 degree right straight, all the people. Only 700 people could be saved. And he was inside the freezing waters. But he never gave up. He saw a young man in the waters. He saw a young man in the waters and John Harper asked,
"Oh, young man there, do you believe in Jesus? Believe in Lord Jesus Christ, you will be saved. Are you saved? Believe in Lord Jesus Christ, you and your household will be saved." "Take this life jacket. You need it more than me. Praise God. Praise God."
John Harper gave his life jacket away. He said, "You young man, you need this life jacket more than me. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved." And the story goes on to say that the young man was saved. And John Harper succumbed to the cold, freezing waters and he lost his life. After a year, after the wreckage of the Titanic, the survivors were having a meeting. And this young man stood up and he said, "I am John Harper's last convert. I gave my heart to Jesus and today I'm working for the Lord. Praise God." When the passengers boarded the ship that day, there were three classes of people. The rich, very rich people, the middle class people, and the poor people. All three classes got into the ship. But when the ship was sinking, there were only two classes of people, those who perished and those who were saved, isn't it? Those who lost their lives and those who survived. So, my dear children, when Jesus comes to this earth, there are going to be only two kinds of people. Those who will give their heart to Jesus and those who will be saved. and the others who will be lost because they have not given their heart to Jesus. They didn't ask for repentance from their sins. So do you want to be saved when Jesus comes a second time? Raise your hands. Let me see your hands. Yes. But it is not so easy to be saved. What do you have to do? You have to be baptized. Yes. Next. Pray to God. Then?
Obey God.
Obey God. Yes.
Read the Bible.
Read the Bible. Yes.
Pray to God.
Pray to God. You want to say something?
Okay.
Okay. So you have to do all this. And you have to, your classmates in your class should talk to them about Jesus. Okay? Then Jesus will take us to heaven. You want to say something?
We should also preach.
Yes. When you grow up, okay, to become a young man, then you should preach. Okay, repeat this memory verse after me. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ.
Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ.
And thou shalt be saved.
And thou shalt be saved.
Acts 16:31. Thank you, children. Okay, bye. Go back to your places.
Thank you.
Happy Sabbath, Church. Happy Sabbath. For our scripture reading, let us all turn our Bibles to Mark chapter 4, verses 13 to 20. I am reading from New King James Version. Mark chapter 4, verses 13 to 20. And he said to them, "Do you not understand this parable? How then will you understand all the parable? The sower sows the word, and these are the ones by the wayside where the word is sown. When they hear, Satan comes immediately and takes away the word that was sown in their hearts. These likewise are the ones sown on stony ground, who, when they hear the word, immediately receive it with gladness. And they have no root in themselves, and so endure only for a time. Afterwards, when tribulation or persecution arises for the word's sake, immediately they stumble. Now these are the ones sown among thorns. They are the ones who hear the word, and the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, and the desires for other things entering in choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful. But these are the ones sown on good ground, those who hear the word, accept it, and bear fruits, some 30-fold and 60, and some 100. May God bless the scripture just read.
Good morning, dear brothers and sisters, and happy Sabbath to all of you. I thank God for giving me this privilege to stand before you as we are here the last 3 days as a group of children ministry directors. We are here. It is our privilege to stand before you and share from the Word of God. I bring greetings from Children Ministry Department of Southern Asia Division. This is the time every year we come here and train some children so that they can go to the places where children, unreached place where children are, nobody reached there to conduct VBS workshop. So we are here for 3 days. I like to thank God for giving me this privilege, and especially I like to thank our beloved VC and our church pastor to giving me this opportunity to share from the Word of God. Before we open our scripture, let's close our eyes and pray. Our most Father in heaven, we like to submit ourselves to you. Fill us with the Spirit. We invite your presence. We like to give us the receptive mind so that we may understand thy word. We pray this in Jesus' worthy name. Amen. Now, when Jesus was in this world, many times, many instances, he used the word must to let his people know about the necessity and urgency of that particular message, must. For example, we can think about a picture of young Jesus in the temple telling to his father, parents, in Luke, which we find in Luke chapter 2, verses 49. Luke chapter 2, verses 49, he says, "Why did you seek me? Did you know not that I must be about my father's business?" Yes, I must be about my father's business. Here, must is not just a suggestion, but it is a divine call. Jesus knew for what purpose, for what he had come to this world, into this world. He knew he had to fulfill his purpose in this world. That's why he added must. If you first forward to his Galilean ministry, which we find in Luke chapter 9, verse 22, Luke chapter 9, verse 22, where Jesus declares, "The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised the third day." Must, again, the Son of Man must suffer many things. Now, in these words, we witness the gravity of his mission, that there would be no other alternative to his sacrifice, but ultimately he would triumph over death. Now, then a moment with Nicodemus, we in John chapter 3, verse 7, we see, John chapter 3, verse 7, where Jesus asserts, "You must be born again." See, again, must is an important word. You must be born again. Here, must is not a casual recommendation. It is not a casual recommendation, but it is the foundation for entering into a life-changing relationship with God. Not simple word, life-changing relationship with God, highlighting the urgency of spiritual rebirth. So we can see that different places, different meaning was there, so he added this must. Now let us consider his words in John chapter 9, verse 4. John chapter 9, verse 4, it says again, "I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day." I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no one can work. So this must signifies an urgency, a call to action, isn't it? It is urgency. We must work when there is no time. It is an urgency, a call to action while there is still time. And we emphasizing the limited opportunity to carry out the work of God. Why did Jesus say that night is coming when no one can work? Why did he say it? Indeed, while sometimes many occupations, they require nighttime work, isn't it? But farming is not among them. Farmers usually work during daylight hours. But some other places we see that it needs required nighttime work. Agricultural activities often rely on natural light for optimal productivity. Working at night may not only compromise the quality of work, but also disrupt the natural rhythms of plants and crops, potentially affecting their growth and yield. So sometimes we required to work nighttime, sometimes we cannot do our work during nighttime. Now Christ has called each one of us over here presented to be sowers of his word. Those who are present here, each one of us, God has called each one of us, and that's why we are here present, here this morning in his sanctuary, because he has called each one of us to be sowers of his word. He has called us to follow his example in service to others by proclaiming his truth and righteousness to the world, to tell to the world and announcing his second coming. That is the work we are here to do, to go to the world and tell, announce his second coming. But remember, in this worldwide church of almost 21 million people are called to partner with the heavenly sower. And heavenly sower is Jesus Christ. In proclaiming his final message, and what is the final message? Three angels' message. All of us, we are there. And that's why that is our work, to preach about three angels' message. Only Adventists, we are preaching this three angels' message, proclaiming his final message of love, righteousness, redemption, and last day prophetic warning. What is the prophetic warning? There is no time now. Jesus is coming soon, right? Jesus is coming soon, and which is everywhere we are there, we are preaching, we are telling others that his final coming is very soon. Everyone is a sower, as I told, that all of us, we, those who are present here, we are a sower. Everyone is a sower. Now let's learn together, turn to Mark chapter 4, verse 3 to 9. Mark chapter 4, verses 3 to 9. In this passage, Jesus was speaking to thousands by the Sea of Galilee near the beautiful plain of Genesaret. Now the listeners could see on that plain and on the hillsides beyond the sowers and reapers who were busily casting seed and harvesting the early grain. We all of us, we know this story. You can imagine what was the scene was there. The listeners are there. Sowers and reapers were there. They were busily casting seed and harvesting the early grain. Now Mark chapter 4, verses 3 to 9, that is a beautiful story. It says, "Listen, behold, a sower went out to sow. And it happened, as he sowed, that some seed fell by the wayside, and the birds of the air came and devoured it. Some fell on stony ground, where it did not have enough much earth, and immediately it sprang up because it had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, it was scorched, and because it had no root, it withered away. And some seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no crop. But other seed fell on good ground and yielded a crop that sprang up, increased and produced, some 30-fold, some 60, and some 100. Now, what did Jesus want the disciples and us to understand about everyone being a sower of this precious truth in the Word of God? He went on to explain the parable of the sower, which we see in Mark chapter 4, verses 14 to 20. My sister just read for the scripture reading. In the verse 14 says, "The sower sows the word. The sower sows the word." Now Matthew 13:37 indicates that the sower of good seed was the Son of Man. And who is Son of Man? Son of Man is Jesus Christ. He came not as a king, but as a sower, pointing to a great harvest. He came here as a sower. When Jesus was here 3.5 years, he did that work only. He pointing to a great harvest that could result after challenging difficulties. Jesus left his heavenly home, came down to this earth to sow the word of God on this earth. See, how great is he? Being a God, he came down to the earth to sow the word of God on this earth. But we are to partner with him as sowers of the truth. Now, Christ Object Lessons, pages 36 to 37, it says there, "His servants in like manner must go forth to sow. So those who are called to unite with Christ must leave all in order to follow him. In toil and tears, in solitude and through sacrifice must the seed be sown. It is not so easy life. There will be toil and tears, solitude and through sacrifice you have to go through if you want to be a sower. Everyone is a sower of the word, isn't it? Everyone, those who are here, sowers of the word, we go out, preach. All of you have experience. The Bible says in Mark chapter 3, verse 14, it says, then he appointed 12. Jesus had 12 disciples. He appointed them that they might be with him and that he might send them out to preach. Jesus sent them out to preach. What a wonderful preparation was theirs. To be with Jesus, to hear his preaching, to see his mighty miracles, and observe his kindness and love for this sinful world. So Jesus appointed them, these 12 disciples, to do his work. And there, these 12 disciples, their message was for the world was, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. They preached, they went to the different places and preached the kingdom of heaven is at hand. They had to tell what they had seen. They were to tell what they heard of him and must tell to all the world. Whatever they have seen, whatever they have heard, they must tell to the world. This task was not so easy work. It was impossible. Impossible from a human point of view. A few weak men were sent to grapple with all the might of the heathen world. Their case seemed desperate. Success seemed impossible, but it was the Lord who sent them there. And here was their hope and strength. But they went, and what wonderful results followed. You have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine, was the cry of their critics. It seems probable that Thomas came to India, establishing churches of Christians wherever he went and preached the gospel. Paul and his companions also were sent, and concerning their work in Thessalonica, and complained of their enemies was their enemies. They complained that these who have turned the world upside down have come here too. Others also traveled far, preaching Christ and him crucified until their witness was given to the well-known world. The record of their lives abounds with deeds of sacrifice. You have to sacrifice if you go and go out and talk about. We have seen that Jesus' time, his disciples also had to sacrifice. They abound with the deeds of sacrifice, courage, and triumph. They had to face martyrdom at the end of his ministry. We know, all of us know, that Paul, he had to go through. Paul could say, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my task, course. I have kept the faith. A story is told about a bus driver. Every day the bus driver had to wait 7 minutes at the end of his route in an ugly part of town, waiting to start his tour again. He noticed an empty lot full of garbage, plastic bags and junk all over scattered. So day in and day out, the bus driver looked at the those dirty place. Then one day he made a decision. He thought, I have to do something over here, something to be done about this ugly sight. He got out of the bus, of his bus, and started filling a big garbage bag with debris. 7 minutes every day he used to wait. So after 7 minutes later, he was on his way again. This became his daily routine. He would stop, get out of the bus, clean that place, dirty place. Again, he will start after 7 minutes. The people in the area noticed that change. Once all the garbage and dirt had been removed, that place became clean. So driver took some flower seeds and the bags of earth to that place, and he began to plant a garden. The people who read about this in the newspaper, they started coming there to see that final stop. Some would help the bus driver to help him to make his garden to help him, and others would just enjoy the beautiful sight. 7 minutes every day were enough to change and inspire an entire community. Just 7 minutes. I want to draw your attention back to the parable of the sower and the seed. Though we are first called to participate with Jesus in sowing the seeds of truth in the minds of people, there are also other important supporting work that needs to be done. And what work we need to be done? Through Jesus' explanation of the parable, we see that different types of soil and environmental conditions influence the outcome of sowing. Not only just put seed and sow, but there are some differences there, which we find in Mark chapter 4, verse 4. Mark chapter 4, verse 4, it says, "And it happened as he sowed, that some seed fell by the wayside." All of us, we know that story. The sower was sowing, some seed fell on the wayside, and the birds of the air came and devoured it. Mark 4:15 says, "And these are the ones by the wayside where the word is sown." Wayside, the word is sown. When they hear, some people, they hear, but Satan comes immediately and takes away the word that was sown in their hearts. Not really it went to in their heart. Immediately Satan comes and takes away the word from their heart. My question to you, dear church members, is this: what can you and I do to prevent the birds from snatching away the precious words of truth even before they could germinate? What is our duty before they got the message, but Satan is there to devour it? But as a, what you and I can do to prevent the birds from snatching away the precious words of truth even before they could germinate? Ellen G. White writes in Christ's Object Lesson, page 45, she says, "Many who profess to be Christians are aiding the temper of to catch away the seeds of truth from other hearts. Many who listen to the preaching of the word of God," we are sitting here, we are listening, the word, the preacher is preaching and we are listening the word of God, "make it the subject of Christian criticism at home. The minister's character, motives, and actions, and the conduct of fellow members of the church are freely discussed, isn't it? We don't take it, but we criticize. We criticize the minister's character. We criticize his motives and actions and conduct to fellow members of the church are freely discussed. And what we do, we are discussing in front of our children. Often these things we talk about as parents, we talk about in front of our children, our own children. Thus, the destroy respect for God's messenger, isn't it? So what our children will learn and reverence of their message. And many are taught to regard lightly God's word itself. So this is our condition. My dear elders of this church, when we speak with caution. When we speak with caution. Be careful. The young ones around you are there. They are listening to you. Instead of words that bring doubt, words that could take them away from God, isn't it? It is our duty as a parents, as elders, that what we speak with caution. Talk about forgiveness. Talk about love. Talk about kindness of Jesus. Show your children your sincerity in doing good and being good. The sower has done his work of sowing, right? But our job as elders is to protect the seeds of truth from the devil who comes to snatch away. Devil is ready to snatch away the truth, to see our children, and is ready to devour it. Now let us now look into the second type of soil as we are discussing about. Second type of soil, which we find Mark chapter 4, verses 5 and 6. 5 and 6. Some fell on stony ground, where it did not have much earth, and immediately it sprang up, because it had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, it was scorched, and because it had no root, it withered away. 16 and 17 says, these likewise are the ones sown on stony ground, who, when they hear the word, immediately receive it with gladness, and they have no root in themselves, and so endure only for a time. Afterward, when tribulation or persecution arises for the word's sake, immediately they stumble. Some are very quick to listen. You have noticed, you have experienced that some people, before you complete your sentence, they will say, yes, yes, I know. This type of people are there, right? Immediately they will listen. Look at what Jesus says about people who, when hear the word of God, they immediately receive it with gladness. It is interesting to note that when Jesus called his disciples, they immediately accepted Jesus and follow him. Most of the disciples, Jesus told them, come and follow me. They came and followed him. Let us read Matthew chapter 9, verse 9. It says, as Jesus passed on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax office, and he said to him, follow me. So he arose and followed him. There was no hesitation. There was no questioning. There is no thought of the profit of his business to be exchanged for poverty and hardships. Immediately he left all these things and followed him. It was enough for Matthew that he was to be with Jesus, that he might listen to his words and unite with him in his work. So there are many like Matthews we have who readily accept Jesus. They continue in the faith, right? They continue in the faith when everything goes well. But when trouble comes, when difficulty comes, when the sun starts beating hard, because of their faith is shallow, because it has not developed roots, it quickly withers away. My question to you, dear church members, is what can you and I do to prevent new church enthusiastic church members, those who have readily accepted Jesus, from withering away? Some of them are very anxious to accept Jesus Christ. What you are going to do, those who are readily accepted Jesus, from withering away? Loosen the soil, till the ground, remove the stones and that prevent the plant from growing a strong root. We could break up that stony ground. As a friends, as a church members, we can break up the stony ground with kind, with lovingly kindness, consistent care for the real life needs of new believers, those who are coming. Supporting their marriages, supporting their parenting, and their new healthy lifestyle choices. We can help them to be like that. When Peter responded to Jesus' call, he left his occupation. His old way of doing things he left. But Jesus knew that Peter was a work in progress. His stony heart needs to be broken. When Peter, under the cheat of public scorn, denied his master thrice, Jesus knew that he had to be patient with him. So when Peter came with full of guilt, returned to his master, Jesus embraced him. So is the case with our brothers and sisters too. We all are different by our nature, who seem to lack a strong foundation and look like withering away. Let us be patient with our brothers and sisters. Let us be patient with them, just as Jesus, who has not given up on us but wants everyone to be saved, every one of us to be saved. If you read Galatians chapter 6, verse 9, it says, "Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if you do not give up." In the time of when there is a time for everything, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest. Maybe you have sown a seed, but that nothing came up, but one day we'll see that in proper time that harvest will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Let us look into the third type of soil. Mark chapter 4, verse 7, it says, "And some seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no crop." Mark chapter 4, 18 and 19 says, "Still others, like seed sown among thorns, hear the word, but the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth, and the desires for other things come in and choke the word, making it unfruitful." Here Jesus warns about the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth, and the desires of other things that might choke one's spiritual life. This world is full of attraction, isn't it? The worries, desires for other things might choke our spiritual life, might choke our brothers and sisters' life. Every class of people, they faces different temptation, different worrying about worldly concerns. The poor worry about working hard, right? Poor worried about facing scarcity. Poor people worried about not having enough. The rich also worry about losing what they have and dealing with many stressful concerns. So we all of us have worry about our own life. Ellen G. White writes in Christ Object Lesson, page 51 and 52, "Christians must work, they must engage in business, and they can do this without committing sin. But many become so absorbed in business that they have no time for prayer, no time for the study of the Bible, no time to seek and serve God. Communion with God through prayer and the study of His word is neglected." Yes, when we are busy with our earthly pleasure, when we busy with our earthly desires, When we're busy with our earthly things, we have no time for prayer, no time for the study of Bible, no time to seek and serve God, no time to communion with God through prayer and study. It is very sad. Most of us, or few of us, are like this, but we have no time. We are busy with our own work. We have forgotten that we can see this day because of His grace, His mercy, but we are forgotten. We take it as a granted that this is life, and so we don't remember our Creator. Just because of His grace and mercy, we can see this day, but we have no time. Study of His word is neglected. They forgot that Christ has said, without me, we can do nothing. Isn't it? Without God, we cannot do anything. Without God, we cannot come to Him also. Without Him, we cannot ask forgiveness. Each step of our life, as we are taking, without Him, is impossible. My question to you believers is, what can you and I do to prevent a church member, a child, or a friend from being choked by the cares of this world? In the formative years of a child's life, the responsibility of a parent is great. Parents should make every effort to surround their children with the right influence. Parents, great responsibility we have. You should surround your children with the right influences. The influences that will give them a correct view of life. Whatever you are giving them, it will show your children the correct view of life and its true success. But instead of this, how many parents make it their first object to secure to their children worldly prosperity? If you are a parent, I'm sure all of us, we are over here, your parents. If you are a parent, pause from your busy schedule and take time to gather around the family altar every day. Make it routine, make it necessity, make it a desire that everyone at home would come to seek the Lord first in their lives. As a parents, this is our duty, this is our routine, this is our necessity, so that we may bring our little ones, bring our family into the foot of the altar every day. We must teach our young ones the importance of stewardship. Stewardship is all about prayerfully and carefully and managing and sharing everything that God has committed to our care, our time, our talent, our treasure, testimony, and so much more which God has given to us. We need to teach our children about stewardship. If you are a spouse, share each other's burden so that you can find time for your Lord. If you are a friend, and if you know that your friend is struggling, extend a helping hand so that she or he can see your good works and glorify your Heavenly Father. If you belong to a church, help each other in hand need so that the cares of this world do not choke an individual of his or her time with God. That is our responsibility as a church member. For each one of us, we have responsibility for each other. Mark chapter 4 verse 8 says, but other seed fell on good ground, and yielded a crop that sprang up, increased and produced some 30-fold, some 60, and some 100. A good ground does not just happen, isn't it? There needs to be a tiller who prepares the ground, loosen up the soil, remove the stones and rocks, uproot the weeds, and add nutrients to the soil. Then only there will be good soil and seed will grow and produce fruits. Psalm 30-fold, Psalm 60, and Psalm 100. Now Jesus has called each one of us to labor with him in the world. Each one of us, as I said beginning, those who are present here, Jesus has called each one of us to labor with him in the field. There is urgency in his call. We all are living in the last days of the world history, that there is urgency, his call. His coming is very near, even at the door. But because we are not doing our work faithfully, we are not prepare ourselves or others, so he is delaying. But there is an urgency in his call. Just as the hymn says, work for the night is coming. Work through the sunny noon. Fill brightest hours with labor. Rest comes sure and soon. Give every flying minute something to keep in store. Work for the night is coming when man works no more. Time is very short, my dear brothers and sisters in the here. Dear saints of God, with you heed to respond to Jesus' call. Jesus is calling each one of us. Each one of us, young or old, boy or girl, Jesus is calling you. Would you heed to respond Jesus' call? The harvest is truly plenty, but the laborers are few. When we are called to mission, I came to learn was not about doing just one thing, which is sowing, but about helping to build an environment of faith in which the clear proclamation of the word is matched with attentive nurture for the hearers. That is our main duty. We have to nurture them. We go preach and we come back, but we have to nurture those hearers. And then supported by a caring community of established believers. We dare not say it is not our fault that the birds carried them away. We can't shrug our shoulders and imply that the individuals are to blame when mortgages and marriage woes choke out their new commitment to Jesus. According to Jesus' parables, we are in this field as well. Are not only as the fortunate ones growing toward Christian maturity, we are covenanted to all whom God's word is reaching. We are responsible for that. We are responsibility to spread the God's word to each and everyone, offering them a safe, enriching place to flourish. That is our main duty. As it said, work for the night is coming when there is no one to work when night will come. The Lord of harvest, he who also initiates the process by sowing the seed in our heart, accepts nothing else from us. May God bless each and every one of us as we are here doing his work as a sower of the seed, as we plant the seed in each one of our heart. May this is our responsibility to care for them so that life, precious life, cannot be destroyed. May God bless each one of us.
Hello, no.
Hello, hello.
Chip.
Thank you.
Before our congregation prayer, shall we all rise up for the consecration song from our church hymnal 367, Rescue the Perishing, Rescue the Perishing.
We will sing the first stanza and the chorus. Shall we all rise?
Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, snatch them in pity from sin and the grave. Weep for the hurting one, lift up the fallen, tell them of Jesus the mighty to save. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save.
Shall we pray? Our loving and living Father, who art in heaven, we thank you once again for blessing us abundantly, and we thank you for thy word through thy daughter, for the night is coming, work for the night is coming, O Lord. Yes, and we need to be alert, awake, and be enthusiastic in doing thy work. Many times we go away from you and we forget you, O Lord, but help us. You are so merciful and gracious, and you are so loving, and you have died for us on the cross of Calvary. We praise you, O Lord, and help us that we would share thy love to others, proclaim it with all our heart, and help us that we would serve you better, and help us that we would be faithful to you, O Lord, in little things, and especially bless this congregation and the children, the youth, adults, Lord, and the old ones. Bless all who are here present and who are unable to come today. Bless us that we would always be a blessing to others. Help us that we would reach out to children so that they would grow and be your children, O Lord, and help us all to be a witness for you. And help us that we would prepare soul for thy kingdom. And you give us that spirit of power by the Holy Spirit so that we would nurture and empower, and also to reach out to others so that many would know that you are a true God who is going to come again. And at last, help us that we would see you face to face. Till then, let always thy mighty hand lead us. Bless us as we depart from here. Thank you once again for hearing our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Dearly beloved children of God, the Lord bless you and keeps you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. As we walk out of this house of prayer until we meet again. Amen.
Bye.